I've been thinking about press F to pay respects a lot recently. That infamous moment from Call of Duty Advanced Warfare that became a pillar of internet meme culture and still today remains parked in the peripheral vision of discourse, only it's no longer resigned to a conversation piece, now it's almost an idiom. I have a confession. I don't hate it. I feel like most of the humour that's derived from this very pointed and out-of-character moment comes from the fact that it is out-of-character for the series it came from. It's not the message that we have a problem with, but the delivery. Not the jarring attempt at poignancy, but rather the jingoistic first-person shooter it's wedged into. Call of Duty as a series has a problem with the discord between its narrative layer and the happy-go-lucky mass murder that defines its central spine, so understandably things like press F to pay respects feels tacky and, outside of the most generous interpretations, disrespectful. What strikes me about this meme, however, is that it's an attempt at something I've always lamented the absence of in more serious AAA games. Games like 2018's God of War, which marketed itself as a more grown-up experience about grief and fatherhood, but not once offered the player the chance to embrace the softer side of its protagonist. Not just the representation, but also having the player be the one to enact it. Push button to verb has always been an outlier in big budget games. It's as though softer interactions are seen as less marketable, or because of some daft impression that there is a demand that every action has some sort of utility. You can't have something exist for its own sake, of course, because what's the point of that? Through some sort of cursed serendipity, we are offered these minimal contrivances, often good ideas executed poorly, that come and go in the blink of an eye, which begs the question, why do it at all if you're not going to take it seriously? I've been thinking about Advanced Warfare's stupid funeral scene a lot recently because I've been playing a particular samurai game that, while executed a lot better, suffers almost exactly the same problems. With locked blades and sliced throats, fountains of claret peppering the flora-laden landscape, it's impossible to argue against the fact that Ghost of Tsushima is a game about violence. Everything you do is a brutal retort to an invading force. Blades clash, arrows fly, and nameless men defined only by their racial heritage are returned to the earth by the dozen. Whether that is head-to-head in time-honored tradition or through desperate, shameful subterfuge, it's all still violence. There is no diplomacy to be found in the hands of Jin Sakai, no mercy presented to his foes even in defeat. The game's central moral crisis isn't about the futility of war or the waning possibility of peace, it's about which way to cut off someone's head is more honourable. However, while defined by a landscape of prospective corpses, Ghost of Tsushima is clearly not just a mindless hack and slash. Or rather, it is clear that this is not how its developers intended to be seen. Were it the case that swinging blades and knocking arrows were the total sum of its parts, I would cynically argue that this is another example of the supreme talent of environmental artists being done dirty by a design document that doesn't particularly care if there is something else to be gained from it all. But through some of the game's more personal, non-violent interactions, I find myself thinking twice. Maybe it isn't just a game about violence. Between bouts of bloodshed, you might find yourself in these moments of reflection, of common humanity, pockets of engagement that don't last very long and rarely exist without some motive furthering the visceral central spine, but that still stand out as something worthy of pursuit, regardless of reward. The island of Tsushima is vast and vibrant and littered with the remnants of a recently displaced populace. Yes, almost all of it is under the thumb of Khotun Khan's army and very little remains cinder-free and unbroken, but it is clearly not intended to be enemy territory in the way many open-world games inadvertently present themselves. In its attempt to authentically recreate a specific era of Japanese history, it shows the island ripe with the signs of a defined culture that may have been paved over in some parts by an unwelcome guest, but still remains visible and undeterred. Rescued citizens frequently reunite with you, your interactions brief and usually not without mechanical purpose, but it helps to cement the idea that your very own rondo of blood is in aid of something more noble than just revenge. You're doing all this for them, so that their lives can return to something resembling normality. A casual swipe on the touchpad even offers the ability to show reverence to your neighbors, something I found myself doing a lot on my journey, purely because it felt like the appropriate thing to do. You can't forget etiquette just because the barbarians are at the door. As an aside, the othering in this game is pretty bad. The Mongols might as well be Dark Souls enemies for all the nuance and thought they are given compared to the rest of the cast. Aside the honourable bow, the touchpad is home to many nice, touches. Not just limited to using the wind as your waypoint and doing that incredibly cool thing where you flick the blood off your sword before sheathing it. A swipe to the left brings out a flute and a peaceful tune is drawn from Jin Sakai. As your journey progresses, subsequent songs will be unlocked that impact the weather in a given region, but there's really nothing stopping you from finding a flower-laden glade or a peaceful vista and just belting out a tune for your own sake. I found myself doing this a lot in the aftermath of intense bloody encounters, a way of winding down and finding peace within, and again, there's no real reason to do this beyond self-gratification. It's just a nice juxtaposition, and it helps further craft the idea that there is more to this protagonist than just the ability to fight well. There are context-sensitive actions galore all across Tsushima. You might desire to indulge in the island's many hot springs, where you can park your juicy peach to relax and reflect on the people in your life. There is motive to using each spring, as doing so increases your maximum health, but as far as I can tell, who you choose to reflect on doesn't matter. Or rather, it does, but only to you. Spending time alone became a nice reprieve from the chaos of combat for me, so I appreciated the shrines that require you to channel your inner Lara Croft to get to, as well as the option to seek out a quiet spot to sit and compose a haiku. An anachronism, sure, but a beautiful way to appreciate the landscape as more than just the stage for combat. And the fox dens, where an enthusiastic vulpine friend will take you on a short detour to find a shrine that gives you extra charm slots, became a worthy detour for me, not for the material gains, but because you can pet the fox afterwards. Everyone loves a chance to pet a very good boy. It's interesting that despite these moments being far, far more rudimentary than the game's combat system, they were the things about Ghost of Tsushima I was most enamored with. But these examples highlight the game's single biggest issue. It doesn't go far enough. Much like Call of Duty Advanced Warfare, which is a terrible comparison, I know, it offers a pittance to the audience it thinks it might ensnare, but nothing more, as though it fears too much of the gentle and the humane would diminish the impact of its very serious and grown-up storytelling. Ghost of Tsushima's identity is intrinsically tied to violence, to asserting dominion over others, and what little mercy it offers to the player only serves to remind them that for all its pomp and circumstance, this is just, eventually, a battleground, not an immersive world. There are no meaningful relationships beyond those heavily scripted, no ways to interact with the people you've rescued beyond a bow and taking all their supplies from them to make a better hat, and it's all the more disappointing for how much effort has clearly gone into building a game world to be representative of a real place and time. It could have done more. It could have had the means to further set a sense of community on an island that seems bereft. It could have offered a beautiful dichotomy between the brutal and the serene, each in turn amplifying the impact of the other. The bowing to others and the petting of foxes, the haikus and impromptu flute concerts, and getting your bum out to remember your family and friends, it's all there plain as day, but it exists in a vacuum, in its own separate bubble that makes me wish for a different game altogether. What's there is good, and at times even great. The combat slaps and the world is gorgeous to look at, and thanks to concerted efforts to create a more organic interface, the screen is largely free of the clutter that is endemic of these kinds of open world games. I wish, however, that more developers, designers, and in particular the publishers behind big studios would have faith that a diverse language set only makes these experiences better, having the player be able to engage with the world in ways that have their own intrinsic value goes a long way to helping immerse them in it. And maybe, if Call of Duty had more than just press F to pay respects, the idea wouldn't seem so laughable.